As I mentioned in a previous video, validity is incredibly important for any research study, whether it's an experiment or not. What validity basically refers to is how truthful is your experiment. And it comes in two kinds. You have internal validity and external. So internal validity, that refers to, you know, how accurate are your study's results on their own. Like, did you actually answer your hypothesis? Do your results make sense? And then external validity, that refers to how well can you generalize from this one study to other groups of people, to other experiments, to the general population. So obviously you need both. You want your study to make sense and you want it to be able to be generalized to other situations. So when it comes to things that might threaten this validity, well, there's a long list of potential threats. And particularly when it comes to internal validity, you know, threats to your internal validity, we're talking about basically any factor that allows for an alternative explanation of your results. For example, let's say you're this clinician studying the effectiveness of a new medication. So you measure your participants before and after they receive it. So this would be an example of within subjects design. Now you observe some differences between these measurements, but these differences might be due to the medication, or it might be due to something like order effects. You know, maybe simply the fact that time has passed, or maybe changes in the weather, or there's any number of potential things that could happen between these multiple measurements you took. And that's what I mean by threats. You know, those things, they might be problems, they might be, you know, extraneous variables, they might be confounds, but you're not entirely sure. They certainly could be, and that's why we refer to them as threats. Now, what this all means when you have these kinds of threats to your internal validity is that you just need to try to recognize them when they're there. You need to understand you can't always deal with them. Sometimes it's impossible to completely remove all of these threats. But the fact that threats are always going to be there, it implies two things. Number one is research studies vary in terms of their validity. Some studies are a lot more valid than others. You know, some studies, the results just make a lot more sense than others. To put it simply, not all science is created equal. Some studies are just better. Some studies are much worse. In fact, some studies have so many threats to their validity, the best word to describe them is crap research. You know, this is just bad research. This kind of stuff shouldn't get published, but it sometimes does for reasons. But my point is, I'm not saying that the researcher's data, you know, I'm not trying to say that they were right or wrong in their argument. What I'm trying to say here is the data just has so many problems with it, it doesn't really matter if they're right or wrong. There's just too many potential problems with this experiment. And this all comes back to something we were talking about earlier on in the semester. Just because we find evidence for a hypothesis, that doesn't mean that that is true. You know, remember, science can't prove anything. We never prove things in science because there's always potential threat there. There's always a chance we could be wrong. The other implication, besides, you know, the fact that research studies vary in terms of their validity, is that if we can be aware of these threats, as a reader, if you can be aware of these threats, then that will allow you to be a better critic of science. You know, when you see something being published on the news, when you see some article being put online, you'll just have a more critical eye and you'll be able to more accurately identify studies that are good quality versus studies that are just, you know, garbage, basically. Now, when it comes to threats to your ability to generalize to other participants, to other groups, to the general public, you know, those threats to external validity, we're basically just talking about any characteristic of a study that just limits your ability to generalize the results. And these come in three basic categories. First category is threats to your ability to generalize across participants. So threats to your ability to generalize to other kinds of people. Category two is threats to your ability to generalize across features of a study. We'll talk a little bit more about that in just a moment. And category three would be generalizing across features of the measures. So we'll go into that in a little bit of detail as well. So the first one, generalizing across participants or subjects, what we're just talking about here are things like selection bias. You know, selection bias, this refers to when your sampling procedure favors certain kinds of participants, producing a non-representative sample, a biased sample. To put it another way, your participants just, they aren't like most people. They're a special group of people that just have, they don't really have much in common with the general public. This is especially a problem in a lot of psych studies, especially like social psychology studies, because they tend to use convenience samples. That's typically the norm. And the most convenient sample to most social psych researchers are college students. This is why we often say that, you know, as a college student, you should be studying psychology because psychology is the study of college students. You know, we've learned so much about college students, but we don't really know as much about other kinds of people. So that's basically what I mean when it comes to, you know, threats generalizing to other kinds of people. There's other kinds of things as well in this category, like volunteer bias. You know, we do generally study college students, but we don't always force college students to participate. So what we're actually collecting in most of these studies is a subgroup of a subgroup. We're selecting the most proactive, like, volunteers within this college student subgroup. So you can see how this is getting more and more removed from the general public. The general public doesn't go to college, and the general college student doesn't just volunteer for studies. So this can clearly become quite a big problem. And then you have category two, you know, threats to generalizing across features of a study. So what we're talking about here are things such as novelty effects. You know, when your participants just respond to a new situation, they respond differently due to the fact that they're doing something new. Like, if you're a researcher, you don't want to study how they respond to something new in most conditions. As a researcher, you want to see people as they really are. But when you bring them to the laboratory, that's new for them, and they're not going to be acting normally in your laboratory. There's other things like in this category, such as multiple treatment interference, which we talked about earlier. That just refers to the fact that testing somebody multiple times can influence their performance in a few ways, like practice effects and fatigue. And then something else I mentioned earlier is experimenter characteristics. You know, the personality and the demographics of the person that's doing this study, that can also be a threat to your external validity, because the person who's doing the study isn't going to be doing the study in all the laboratories. You're just doing it in this particular laboratory. So if somebody else wants to repeat your study, they don't have you to do it. You know, they're going to have to do it. And the difference in personality between you and the other researcher could be a confound. And then you have category three. Category three refers to those threats to generalizing across features of the measures. There's a few different things we could talk about here, but the basic idea of this category three is something called sensitization. So a sensitization, we're talking about a threat that occurs when the way you measure people alters them. And as a result, they react differently to future treatments. They react differently than they would in the real world. You can call this assessment sensitization or pretest sensitization. This just basically means you bring somebody into your laboratory, you tell them you want to measure them, and just the fact that you're measuring them changes those measurements. If you've ever studied things like physics, for example, this might sound familiar. This is conceptually similar to what's called the observer effect. The whole idea there is you can't measure something without changing it. Then there's a few other threats to generalizing across features of measures. Generality across response measures, you know, variables can be defined and measured in many different ways, and the way in which you measure can sometimes produce dramatically different results. All I really mean by this is, you know, exactly what unit of measurements you use, what kind of rulers you use, you know, things like that. Like the actual tools themselves, those could potentially be a source of confound if they're at all a little bit different. And there's some other things in this category as well, but that's the basic idea. You just want to make sure you're using the exact same kind of measures every time and that those measures aren't influencing your participants, which is very hard to do.